Good morning, friends. Well, behind me is the 3GM 30FC Yanmar engine. A few weeks ago, I was just doing a routine inspection and I noticed some coolant leaking out the weep hole of the water pump. So the plan today is to swap out the water pump. While I'm at it, I'm going to have a look at the exhaust elbow and I'm going to decalcify the heat exchanger. I hope you come along. We'll start by closing the seacock on a sail drive. So this is my saltwater intake and I'm going to loosen this off mainly because if there's a small leak in the seacock, I want to break the siphon so water can't siphon into my boat. Now there are two drains for fresh water coolant. There's one over here on this side at the heat exchanger, and that one works pretty well, and then there's another one at the engine. The engine's a little bit lower, and I find that this one works a little bit better and it's less messy, so I'm going to undo that one first. Now let's remove the cap. That's the color of my fluid there. Now it's coming nicely. I just had to loosen that off a little bit further. You can see it right there. So while that fluid is draining, let me give you a look at where this weep hole is. It's right up there. You can see it. It's got a brownish discoloration from the liquid. Some days it's been quite bad, but it's never been bad enough to justify adding coolant. So why not just leave it? Well, you could leave it. The bearings aren't giving a problem. But eventually what will happen is those bearings will seize, the liquid will damage the bearings and they'll seize. And at first it'll start giving a loud sound as a warning, but if you ignore the warning, what will happen after that is the belt could snap, the bearing could completely seize and the belt could snap, and then you're hooped, you can't use your engine or it'll overheat. Now I'm going to drain the spigot on the heat exchanger. This is a 12 millimeter bolt right here. I'm just going to undo that bolt and then it'll drain out this tube into the bucket. A couple of years ago, I did a cooling system video explaining how the system works, and we incidentally discovered that the spigot valve on the starboard side had plugged off. Here's a clip you haven't seen from last year where I removed the spigot and then pushed a loop of wire up into the hole to help flush debris out. Okay, I didn't get any fluid out of the bottom drain, but I'll do the saltwater drain now. And we are getting some saltwater here. Okay, so you might think that the next thing to do would be to take the belt off, but the problem is the belt is going to hold this pulley in place while I take these bolts off. So I'm just going to zip them off now before the belt comes off. Okay, let's talk about what we're going to do with this heat exchanger. Now, there are three ways to decalcify the heat exchanger. The simplest and easiest way is to just hook up a pump with the tubing and pump it through the tubing and then find a way to collect the discharge so that you're not putting any acid into the ocean. That's quick and easy, but it may not do quite as good a job. You don't get to inspect the area. And of course, you've got to be cognizant of the environmental issues. The second approach is to take the whole thing off, and that's what I'd actually prefer to do, take this whole thing right off, if I can do it. Now, I may not have enough lateral room here, because these have to slide off on these studs that are mounted in the engine, but I'd prefer it to do that way. The third possibility is just to unbolt it from either end and then slide it out. And we could do that if we run into trouble. For now, I'm just going to get started with taking all these hoses off and getting some more access. Okay, getting these old hoses off can be a real bear, so it really helps to have a right angle pick. You just work around the outside, or the inside, and try and get it released from the corrosion. And once it's released, we may get a bit of fluid here. All right, let me show you what I've found so far. Getting these hoses off is, as usual, a bear, but have a look at this. This is the exhaust elbow. And look at how corroded that is. So I've got a decision to make. Do I try and get that fitting off? Maybe replace it? Getting this hose in the back off is gonna be tricky as well. It's on there really tightly. Okay, this is the exhaust elbow here, and this is where the exhaust hooks up and it bolts on four of these bolts. The two long ones to the bottom and the two top are shorter. Looks all right from this angle. I just don't know how I'm going to get that hose off. My access here is pretty poor and it looks like it's be a bear to get that thing off. Okay, I got you looking through the access panel. You can see those six bolts that are holding the heat exchanger on there. Okay, I got those six bolts done without too much difficulty. And now I notice that the this fuel filter is bolted on here too as well. So I'm gonna have to get that off to get the whole thing free, so I'm going to undo these two. These are 10 millimeter. Oh, I see it. We're getting caught on this bolt here. This is for the fuel system. I think I might be able to undo it there. Undo it there and give myself an extra centimeter or so. Maybe take this fuel regulator cable off as well.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so let's move the ball forward with this water pump. We've got five bolts here. These are 12 millimeter. Interestingly enough, the most difficult bolt is this one right here. I had to use a 10 millimeter universal joint. I put the bolts into the new water pump just to remember which the long ones are. This one here is the longest bolt right there. And then the shortest bolt is that one right there. And then the other three, the three bottom ones, are all medium length. It seemed like it was stuck on, but I just pulled on it like that and it just came off camera. Now I just need to get this off the bottom hose and then we're out. Hold on, let's pause right here. I made a stupid oversight by not ordering the hose you're looking at right now. Hoses that sit so close to the engine get heat soaked and they soften up over time like this one was. They need to be replaced every time, and they're a lot easier to get at with the pump off. I tried to swap in a generic hose, but the bend is too acute, so I'm going to need to order and wait for a custom OEM hose to come from the dealer. Okay, a little bit of a time-consuming complication here. When I undid the bolts to the water pump, I released the water pump housing as well. And those same bolts hold the housing onto the cylinder head. That's a problem because I have to clean up that joint, and so I have to get the housing off. Now the housing is attached to the alternator bracket, and so I had to take the alternator off. Lots of wires and things, make sure the power is off. Simple enough, but just a time-consuming complication. So here's the back side. Not as bad as I was expecting. This one, this version has the horizontal line as opposed to the more complex one. So here's the front side, and one thing I noticed is that this bolt here is a little different than the others. And I'll just draw your attention to this little hole here and that little nubbin. Those two need to come together. Okay, this is really interesting. So the salt water comes in here, the cold salt water comes in here and gets to these three rows. And you've got this horizontal line, so the salt water can't go into this side initially. And it goes along those three lines. And if you watch, on this side, you've got the same kind of thing. You've got a horizontal line that prevents the salt water from commingling. And so the three bottom ones, it comes out of these three and then goes back in those two. And if you flip it around, it comes back to the front out of those two. And you can see that now it's in the top part of this. It's in the top part of this thing here. And so it can only go back through these. And so it goes a zigzagging course back and forth until it gets to the end plate, and this is the end plate here, and it goes on like this. And so when it finally comes out, it finally comes out here and out the exhaust. Once these outer seals are removed, it's easy enough to slide this out now. I'm surprised how heavy it is. Okay, this is what I'm using, Barnacle Buster. It's the directions call for a 4-to-1 dilution. This is phosphoric acid. Honestly, I don't know that it makes a difference. They advertise that it's not as dangerous as some other compounds. Whatever you do, you always add the acid to the water. So I've put in 4 liters of water, and now I'll put in the phosphoric acid.
can see it's already starting to foam up. All right, it's been a few hours, and now I'm just going through with a gun cleaner and just cleaning off each individual hole. After that, I'll rinse and shut this part down. Now, for the housing overnight, you probably noticed that it was quite rusty, and so I'm doing some electrolysis here to deal with the superficial rust, both inside and outside. Right now I've got about 1.7 amps flowing, and I'm using this washing soda, and this is my sacrificial anode here. I've used that a few times, and of course it's hooked up to the positive side of the battery. So as an anode, it's always a source of electrons in the wire, and so the electrons are going back to the positive side of the battery. The positive current is going, of course, the opposite way. And I'll leave that overnight, and we'll see how much rust is there in the morning. Okay, I'm putting the heat exchanger back together, and I found something interesting. Of course, this little nubbin goes at the top, but what I find interesting is that this bump is canted over to the left more than the right, and you can actually see that. There's the bump there. It's a little bit to the left, and the reason that's important is that this gasket, although it looks like it's symmetrical, if you put it on wrong, it's got a little notch on it, and you'll see it doesn't line up properly. So what you have to do is you have to flip it over and do it that way so that everything is lined up properly. I'm using a little silicone paste here just to hold the gaskets in place and also to give a good surface for the rubber gaskets to press onto. For some reason you have to cut this yourself. Presumably it's made from multiple different. So this one is on the top side so you can see it. It's perfect. This is the exhaust manifold gasket. Interestingly, it's a little bit of an IQ test. It only goes on one way, and it should fit perfectly. And if it's not fitting perfectly, you've done it wrong. You don't need to cut any of these things. You'll find a way that it fits, and all of a sudden it works. Here I'm doing a little screening test to verify that the exhaust elbow hasn't rusted through. I'm siphoning water from above, and then looking for water dripping back the wrong way. It passed. For those of you with the same YEU engine assembled in Europe, here are the parts I ordered and used. Now, Yanmar went through some iterations in the design of their heat exchanger, and some have a V-shaped gasket shown here in the upper right. If you have my engine, that's not the one you want. You want the one shown beside it here. However, it means you need to do some legwork to decide which gaskets are right for you. Okay, so at this point, a lot of professionals would do a pressure test in the lab on the bench to assess the heat exchanger itself. And the advantage of doing it that way is, number one, it's easier to identify where the leak is, if indeed you have one. And secondly, there's no chance of contaminating the waterway with unrecognized small coolant leak. Now, I have the equipment to be able to do a pressure test before I add the coolant on the boat, and I can test the whole system, so I'm gonna do it that way. The catch is, of course, I'm still waiting for parts. I still need that like a coolant elbow and a gasket, and so I'm gonna have to wait for that. So I'm gonna close the video today, and we'll do a part two in the coming weeks to go into more depth about the water pump and the system. Thanks for watching.